Hello everybody, my name is Coolblood, and I'm bringing you all this video of me talking about a board game. This is going to be a continuation of the Final Girl video that I was talking about before, the playthrough, and this is just kind of talking about the modifications and the mods that I'll be using. So there are three mods that I've made, I guess two mods really, this is just a stat sheet. But there are three mods that I'll be using that you'll see throughout this entire gameplay, so I'm going to explain some or explain them as fully as I can within reason here. I will say that there's a Board Game Geek page that I've posted, or forum post that I made, regarding all this information regarding how the Queens of Horror deck works, and there's another post of how the Tenacity dice work. And there's a file page of the actual stats sheet that kind of went through iterations, which is part of the reason why I'm re-recording a lot of this or redoing all this. But all that goes along with to say that yes, these are some things that you'll be seeing consistently during the game. So instead of talking about them every single time that I start a playthrough, I will just mention them here in this one collective video. And for those who don't know, I'm going to be doing the lore playthrough, the lore and scenario playthrough for Hans and Poltergeist. Which are two of the killers available in Final Girl. There's five total, and there's five more on the way. Actually, there's six total in that I have right now, if you include the birds. And there will be six more available soon, which is zombies plus aliens, and then Cabin in the Woods, Red Riding Hood, and some other stuff. Or the wolf, and some other stuff. So, that is just kind of how that goes. So, for right now, we're just going to talk about these mods. So we have the game of Final Girl here, and there's a few mods that make this game more enjoyable for me, so I will play with them. You do not have to play with them yourself. Hopefully this is just still a good display of the game. I think this game has some good bones to it as far as the story, the lore, the atmosphere, the story, and all the stuff. I just don't like some of the mechanics that it forces you to use, that it forces you to kind of stay with. There's a particular formula associated with it, and yes, there's a strategy and approach that actually is successful, blah, blah, blah. But for me to enjoy this game the way I want to enjoy it, I'm going to modify it with these particular things. So you see these featured in other videos. And those things are the Queens of Horror deck that we talked about before. What this is basically just another source of random, and it gives me the illusion of control, if you will, to where I can flip the card, and the card basically reflects the normal dice that you use, which in this game are the horror dice, which have six faces. The one, the two, and the three, the four, the five, and the six. And the difference between those is, if you look at the symbolism here, just in case you don't have this game yourself or you're looking into it, the ones and twos are fails, the threes and fours are partial successes, to which you can make those full successes by discarding two cards from your hand, two valuable cards that you do not get the effects of, and then the fives and sixes are successes. So what we have inside this Queens of Horror deck, and I did do a whole entire video on it, but just to briefly mention it here, just in case this is the only video you see. With the Queens of Horror deck, there are four sets of every number. So there's four ones, there's four twos, four threes, four fours, four fives, and four sixes. And then there's three what I call shuffle indicators. And once two of those shuffle indicators are in my discard, then I get to shuffle. And the primary I have to shuffle the whole deck and continue drawing. And the primary benefit of the Queens of Horror deck, for those who might be wondering, is like, isn't that just dice with more steps? And it's like, yes, that is dice with more steps. But the primary benefit is that the cards do have memory. So once I've played a few cards, I'll kind of be able to weigh my odds. So in this particular deck setup that I have, aces are ones, red queens are fives, and black queens are sixes. So you can just do the numbers one through six if you just want to keep it simple and straightforward. But I want to kind of keep mine thematic and make it look cool. I even got a special deck here, the Tragic Royalty deck. So they have like nice little quirky faces on the face cards. But that's neither here nor there. What this means is that I have some kind of memory in my card, so I can know my odds a little bit more specifically when I actually go to do a roll. And this works in conjunction with the rolling mechanic, because if I'm to make a dice roll to where I have to roll three dice for some reason, so it tells me to roll three dice. At the time before I roll anything, before I flip anything, I can choose how many dice do I want to roll and how many cards do I want to flip. So I can choose that I want to flip two cards and roll one die, and that's my three rolls. So I can do it in whatever order I want, so I'll take this dice and I'll start rolling. So I have one fail from the dice, and then for the cards, this is one, two, and two partial successes. So it basically works like that. Somebody asks the question of, why would you do that? That seems silly. And to me, I would say, that might seem silly to you, but for me to enjoy this game a little bit more, having that kind of knowing control is like, okay, I know this is risky because two of my queens are gone, and there's only eight queens in here, because queens are fives and sixes. Black queens are sixes, red queens are fives. So knowing that there's two queens in here, maybe it was not the best idea to say I'm going to draw two cards. So I might just let it be later, or might do something else, might just roll the three dice. And then the other question might be, well, if your deck becomes so bad, wouldn't you never draw from your deck? And it's like, yes, you can't, or yep, that's true. So to help address that, for the Queens of Horror deck rules, there's a few things you can do to manipulate it. Thing number one, during your planning phase, you can spend three time to remove a card from the discard specifically. Thing number two is that during your planning phase, you can spend two time to force the deck to reshuffle. Also, another thing I forgot to mention that's probably important for me to mention is that when you shuffle the deck, anytime you shuffle the deck for any reason, before you draw any cards, you discard three cards randomly without looking at them. So that way you can, you know what's in the deck, but you don't know what's in the deck. And then you play it like normal. So that's one module that for me has added a lot of enjoyment to the game and has given me that kind of extra little bit of edge and control and stuff, because the stats for the dice are actually very bad depending on how you look at them, which we'll talk about that when we get to the statistics sheet. But I just want to mention that is a thing. So I will be playing with this mod and you'll see this feature throughout the entire playthrough. The next one to talk about will be the Tenacity Dice. And the Tenacity Dice are basically a way to make ones and twos less aggressive, less brutal, if you will. So a big part of this game is the kind of build, or a big part of what builds the atmosphere in this game, or at least what this game tries to use as atmosphere, in my opinion, tries is doing a lot of work in that sentence, is trying to show you that, hey, I see that you want to do this thing, you have this good laid, or you have this well laid plan, well, we're gonna, oh no, disaster strikes, you gotta now adjust. So some people have argued that that's the beauty of it, that's the tacticalness that this game forces upon you. And to me, I would say, okay, I understand that this game is forcing you to adjust your plans, but there's a lot of instances in this game to where bad things happen and unfortunate things happen. What I mean by that is that there's a lot of circumstances and a lot of scenarios to where you end up in just a blender and there's no chance of you getting through the blender. And that is not the most fun thing in the world. So, those things are mostly predicated on dice rolls, just to clarify, just to finish that thought. So if you roll a die and let's say you roll three dice, the chances of you rolling three dice and getting ones and twos is actually kind of low. There's like a 7% chance or 4% chance. No, 4% chance, yeah, based on the statistics table that I have here. So 4% chance that you'll get that roll exactly of a 1-2-1 or a 1-1-2 or a 2-2-2. But it happens, and sometimes you're at a critical moment, you roll the dice and you just get the worst thing in the world, and then you just you couldn't do anything about it. There's nothing you can do about it. So there's a lack of agency in that particular situation. I didn't like that. So Tenacity Dice are the answer to that specific thing without breaking it too much. There's three different levels for Tenacity Dice. I will always play on Nightmare, but there's three levels of Tenacity Dice, and there's a whole write-up on Board Game Geek. I'll link that in the description below, because this is going to go on YouTube, so you see it there. If you're watching this live, let me know, and I can throw it in the chat on Twitch, which also, I'm live streaming all this, by the way. I'm live streaming this currently. But the Tenacity Dice have three different difficulties, which is I'm Too Young to Die, the next one is Hurt Me Plenty, and the final one is Nightmare. And for those who are astute and might hear those names, yes, those were inspired by Doom for easy, normal, and hard mode. So I'll be playing with hard mode on them because I feel like hard mode is like the correct balance for this. And what Tenacity Dice are basically, they're basically just counters for bad, or for failed rolls. So if you're rolling particularly badly in this game, the Tenacity Dice will eventually give you a free star as consolation, whereas in the base game, you have no such recourse for such a thing. There are some situations on cards, like some of the base action cards, for those who don't know, like Walk, for instance, where a complete failure is not the end of the world. A complete failure on a walk, you lose a life, but you get to move a space and you get to move, and you just lose two time. Which, in hindsight, some people might say that's not the biggest deal in the world, it's not the biggest resource exchange. To me, I'll say, yes, it is the biggest resource exchange in the world, because I only got that because the dice said so. Even if I rolled well, or rolled harder, if you will, I was still in a fail situation, but we'll talk a little bit more about that when we get to the stat sheet. The main thing I'm trying to push here is that the Tenacity Dice will give you some sense of, hey, I know you're doing bad, but you're not doing that bad, because eventually you'll get a Tenacity Dice. So just to explain what they actually do, they actually keep track of ones and twos on easy mode, or on the I'm Too Young to Die mode. Basically, any dice roll you make for any reason, whether you keep it or not, whether it's spawning birds, whether it's panic rolls, whether it's moving people around, whether it's the killer doing anything, whether it's a vent, anytime you roll a one or two, either one of these dice can be incremented by one. And once you get to 5, you get a free star, and you can cash in that star in a future turn. And you have 2 of them that you can have at max. So you can have a max of 2 of them. Any D6 can be used for this, by the way. I just use these special dice from Rattlebones because I had a game that had customizable dice that I wanted to make look cool and fancy. So I did that for myself. But if you use a D6, this can be the 6, or the 0 will be the 6 face. And then the 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 will be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And with 5 being the star, and once you have 5 star parts is what I called it, because I did not want to call it star shards, because star shards abbreviated as SS, and we don't do that here. So yeah, star parts. And once you have 5 star parts, you have 1 full star that you can use in a future turn, and that can just be auto success. So for instance, if I'm, same scenario, let's say this is what my board looks like, and I make a roll, or sorry, I'm about to play a card, I'm playing a walk. Assuming that this is my current scenario where I have 3 star parts on this one and a full star on this one, and I need to roll 2 dice. Let's assume that I need to roll 2 dice, just making assumptions here. I can say, okay, I'm going to roll 2 dice. I'm going to make one of those an auto success and then roll the other one like normal. Breaking stuff. And look, a partial success. Yay. So my roll in total is a star and a partial success. And then this is zeroed out once I use it. And if I do re-roll, the caveat to this is if I do re-roll, as in if I want to re-roll so I can get 2 stars instead, then I lose the star I spent, whether I kept that roll or not. So you have to be very cautious and you have to use this very tactically. That's because I don't want people abusing the system as designed, because otherwise, I mean, it's giving you a nice benefit of an auto success, which does give you a little bit more balance, or give you a little bit more power, if you will, in the favor of good, right, as opposed to being so skewed towards evil sometimes, especially on Sacred Groves. Oof. Man, I can talk all day about Sacred Groves. But that goes an extreme long way to say that that's what that does. So on Nightmare Mode, because I talk about easy mode, on Nightmare Mode, which is the mode I'll be playing with, this dice is the 2, this dice is the 1, and anytime I get a fail of a 1, I can increment the 1. Anytime I get a fail of 2, I can increment the 2. And both of these are locked to their individual number. And another thing that's important to note about that is that for Nightmare Mode, that only happens on my horror rolls. So in this game, you make a few different dice rolls for a few different reasons. You make rolls for spawning birds, you make rolls for panic rolls, you make rolls for playing your cards. Anytime I'm playing a card and I make a horror roll and I accept, I keep a 1 or 2, I do not re-roll, then I can get a star shard or a star part. That's important to differentiate between the other modes, because the other modes, you can get the star parts from anything. So from spawning birds, from panic rolls, from moving people around, from choosing what happens at on an event, everything counts for those. But for Nightmare Mode, it's only for the horror rolls that I accept. So if I rolled a 1 or 2 and I have a reroll and I play a reroll and I reroll all of it, I do not get to claim those as star parts. So if I do a roll and, oh, look at that, nice, 2 6s. And I get 2 6s, then great, my life is great. But if I got another failure, so a 1 and a 2, and I was forced to take, or I chose to take that, or let's just make it a little bit better, let's say I got this as a roll. Then in this situation, which is a 5 and a 2, I get 1 star part, and then I get a star for the other one. And then I move on with life. So that's the mode I'll be playing with for this one. And like I said, I'm making this one video to kind of explain all the mods, so I don't have to keep explaining every single video. All right. And that's the Tenacity Dice. So Tenacity Dice, for me, have made the game more enjoyable, because even if I'm rolling really badly, I know I got a Tenacity around the corner. And also, it adds an additional crisis to the game, to where sometimes I'm like, okay, if I accept this roll as is, or let's say this. If I just go ahead and accept... Oh, sorry, let's make this more realistic. If I just go ahead and accept this roll right now, I get a star in the future, but I'm going to fail my walk. Or better yet, let's make it more... Let's make it more perilous. I'm trying to do a short rest, and this is what I get on my roll. And I have a reroll available in my hand, hypothetically. And I have the time to spend to reroll both dice. But if I accept this roll right now, I get a star for the future, and I get to heal 1 anyway. I raise a horror level, which is not great. I lose the time, and my turn ends. But I'm at the end of my turn anyway. Do I want to reroll or not? So I feel like that adds to the atmosphere, that adds to the crisis that you face in this game. So that's why I like that Tenacity one the most. I feel like the Tenacity one probably would be a little bit more popular. The card one, some people don't like, some people do like. Somebody actually said that they're considering replacing the dice completely with the cards, and I was like, oh, that, sure, go for it. If that works for you, whatever brings you joy, right? So that's those two mods. And the last mod to talk about is not really a mod, is more of a statistic sheet. This one has gone through the ringer. More specifically, there was a shout out to a person in Board Game Geek. I know their name. I just don't know if they want to be identified, so I'm not going to identify them. But they posted they sent me a message directly saying, "Hey, Cool Blue, these stats are wrong," because I had a stat sheet that was wrong. I threw away the old stat sheet, so I don't have them with me. And long story short, the stats were wrong. The way I did my math was incorrect, or an improper approach to doing percentages. And after a few posts back and forth, and then a few other posts back and forth, I finally conceded the point that, okay, cool, I see what you're saying. Yes, I did math badly, so I fixed the charts. These charts here show the combinations that you can face and show your percentage chances of rolling certain things. So in this case, this is just a lookup table. That's all it really is, showing your percentages. So if you're rolling one dice, your chances of getting a star, which is a success, is 2 out of 6. So there's 2 out of 6 faces that you'll get that. And then on the other side, there's percentages, so you can actually see the raw percentages. And this is for those who want to know, what are my chances of getting a full success? Now, if you want to consider this game partial successes being an important part of the game too, then I do have another chart that I made that's a part of the same file in Board Game Geek that talks about partial successes. So this takes into account full successes and partial successes. So for full successes and partial successes, when you're rolling one die, because a full success is a 5 or 6 and a partial success is a 3 or 4, there's 4 out of 6 faces. And then when you go up into the permutation, so if you're rolling 3 dice total, there's 216 different combinations. And out of those 216 combinations, there's 208 that have at least 1 star or 1 partial success. So 1 partial success or 1 full success. And then of course, for you to get 3 stars or partial successes, there's 64 total. And if you look on the percentages side, you can see that there's a 30% chance of you actually getting a full success. There's a 30% chance of you getting 3 stars or 3 partial successes, or some mix of those two. So some combination of those two. And the other cool thing about this is that this is also mathematically consistent, which I found a very neat thing, because if you look at the chances for you to get a star, which is 33%, and the chances for you to get a star or a partial success, in this case is a moon, it's a 67% chance. Add those two together, you got 100%. And then scroll on down. If you compare on 2 dice here and 2 dice there, there's a 56% chance for you to get 1 star when you're rolling 2 dice. And then there's a 44% chance of you getting either a star or a partial success when you're rolling 2 dice. So that's mathematically consistent because you're counting more things. And then you add those two, you add these two together, you get 100%. Add these two together, you get 100%. Scroll down, same thing. Add the 74 plus the 26 together, you get 100%. Add the 96% and 4% together, you get 100%. So on and so forth. I thought that was pretty cool because it just mathematically made sense when you do that, when you expand it out. And that was kind of a confirmation that I did the math correctly finally. So anyway. So this is all important information to know, because during the gameplay that I'm going to be doing, you'll be seeing these things show up. I will be using these mods, I'll be using these charts, I'll be using these different things and playing the game. I also will have some dice around, and I'll explain those every single time I start the video, because I feel like that's a kind of tell people as we go thing. But I just wanted to make this video at the top of this series to explain to you what you'll be seeing. Oh, also, you'll be seeing the Palm Island box. Palm Island is a great board game. It's not sponsored by anybody, so I don't really care. Palm Island is a great board game. Would recommend people get it, especially if you can get the plastic card edition. Really fun game. I did a playthrough of it already. Go check out my Small Box Big Game series. I have a playthrough in there somewhere. But it's also a great dice box. So you'll be seeing this in every single playthrough, because it's a very convenient dice box. Look at it. It's just the right size. And it's like, you know, not too tall. You know, it's perfect size. If I can just buy like 10 boxes like this, which I could, I would. I'm not gonna, because I have this one. Thanks, Palm Island. Anywho, that's it for this video. I just wanted to talk about all the mods and all the things I'll be using in my playthrough, because I'm going to be doing the playthrough of Hans and Poltergeist. So that's going to be 10 games total across those things. And yeah, we'll look forward to doing that. So that's it for this video. Let me know in the comments what you all think of all these cool things, and if you like these mods, if you don't like those mods, if you have any suggestions for modifications to make to the mods or your own mods, please let me know. I'm always a fan of hearing how you can approach this game differently in different ways, and also just kind of getting into the whole nitty-gritty of theory crafting different things about the game. Anyway, that's it for this video. Thank you all very much for watching. Hope you all enjoyed it, and as always, I will see you all whenever.